and that other just simply says if it's not specified anywhere else, it falls in that other category. Technological changes, that is very relevant in today's world. As technology advances, the HTS nodes, HTS provisions change. Sometimes they jump from one chapter to another. Highly technological chapters, very important in the HTS hierarchy, are those. High-tech chapters are chapters 84 and 85. Very heavily dominated with technology. You have computers, for example, classifiable in chapter 84, but TV monitors, for example, classifiable in chapter 85. Why are they not classified in one chapter? I don't know. Classifying in the same section makes sense. There used to be a time when computer monitors were classified as inputs, as extensions, in other words, of computers in chapter 84. It was time. And then there was a decision to say, no. The computers will be classified in chapter 85. And so there was a change in nodes, harmonized tariff schedule went through changes, additional numbers were assigned, and this whole new section was created. Similar change, for example, with printers. Were printers part of the, which you use with the personal computers, for example, laser printers, are they like input or rather output units of the computer? Output meaning you attach and it provides some output, printing paper. And then it became the category of its own. Another thing with the flash cards. So we have, let's say, flash cards. How do you classify those? There have been changes with the, for example, prepackaged software. So a lot of change, especially if you look at the last 10 years, let's say, 10, 12 years, a lot of changes went through. So keep this in mind, especially when you do technology, because if you practice like 2005 exam and you're trying to classify a computer, you may be wasting your time because the provision for the computer changed entirely. All right? Now, this is just what I like to call the totality of circumstances list. So those are the factors that shape the HTSUS. We really need to know this because this provides a backing of approaching the HTS, because one factor may be more important than the other, depending on the situation. In case of technology, we know that things change quickly. We know that we need to take care if we approach older exams. we know that use versus make is a always duality, that intention. We can classify very oftentimes, harmonized tariff schedule provides for use and make, which can be fitted for the same particular product. So how do we determine which one is the subject of this journey, really? Because again, you have to look at the specifics. So once we figured out that 10-digit number, one, because GRIs, general rules of interpretation, they really establish the quest, the methodology of how you classify something. They do not tell you about the duty rate, the quota, trade agreements, no. They really tell you how you need to assign, how you put that slab, that 10-digit number label on for the particular product. Of course, behind this is a very important notion. Once you slap that label on, you know how much duty you pay, Are there any trade restrictions, such as free trade agreements, such as quota? What about other government agencies? Because a lot of other government agencies, they regulate the product, assess fees, require certain documentation, permits, for example, based on a harmonized tariff schedule. So if your schedule fits within that provision, then it raises red or yellow flags, and there will be inquiry from sister agencies, not customs per se, but other agencies, such as International Trade Administration, which enforces anti-dumping. They say, hey, look at this. Your HTSUS is exact fit for what we assess anti-dumping duties for. And sometimes anti-dumping duties range as high as 400% of the product. So you have a client and you say, look, I'm sorry, I use the classification, I use the GRI, and I arrive to classification, and as a result of that, your duty rate, regularly speaking, 10%, but there is additional anti-dumping duty, 400%. So there is that thousands and thousands dollars in duties that you have to pay to customs and the International Trade Administration because the product has been determined as dumped. And if this is a first news that your client finds out, there will not be very many smiles. There may be many unhappy faces. So how do you go about that? Well, you establish that early on. And the starting point for me in many instances is the application of GRIs, so you can foresee those type of situations and be able to take preemptive action. Now, all formal entries require classification. When I say formal, that means we have a division, right? Formal and informal, basically speaking. There are other types of entries, but when we compare something, it is useful to compare it to something of what it is not. In case of formal, the good opposite would be informal. What's the difference? There are various differences, but the major one is the monetary threshold. $2,500 goes this way. So if it's less, if it's more. Formal, informal. So for all formal requirements, even some informal require classification, right? Remember the $200 threshold? No HTS. If it's more than 200, even though it's informal, you still have to assign the HTS number. So what does that mean? Most of the time, for majority of the merchandise, you as a licensed customs broker will be required to assign the HTS number. Either it will be provided to you, or you will have to help the client to determine the harmonized tariff schedule number. Because of that, harmonized tariff schedule is one of the pillars of the customs broker exam. Without knowing, if you don't know it, you will not pass the exam. So, GRIs, we've been talking about the GRIs, but what are these GRIs? What are they composed of? What is, what do they say, really? Those general rules of interpretation. Well, first thing that is helpful is we need to know where to look for them, right? And general rules of interpretation are located at the very beginning of the harmonized tariff schedule. Here, general rules of interpretation. Right after preface. They're right here, right after preface. you just click on it or flip through and you get right there. So how many general rules of interpretation, general rules of interpretation do we have? How do we read them? Is very important, because if we do not follow the methodology, we just can get sidetracked, and if we get sidetracked, we really will not be able to constructively assign HTS numbers. So it's very important. How many rules are there? 6. There are 6 rules. So all you are being asked to do is remember those 6 rules. That's all. And even within those 6 rules, most of the time you will be using 3 rules. GRI1, GRI3, GRI6. Those are the heavy hitters. Not to say that you do not need to know the others, but this is the core. It's a must know. So let's start with reading the first rule. And trying to make sense of it. GRI 1 says, classification of goods in the tariff schedule shall be governed by the following principles. So this first sentence really is a preamble. It will list those principles that are given in GRI 1, GRI 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So number 1, table of contents, alphabetical index, titles of sections, chapters, subchapters are provided for ease of reference only. Recall that ease of reference again, we have legally binding versus ease of reference tension. For legal purposes, highlight that, classification shall be determined according to, highlight again, terms of the heading and any relative section or chapter notes, provided that such headings and notes do not otherwise require according to following provisions. And provided that can be is a prelude to the other general rules of interpretation. So, what do we make out of it? We start with GRI 1. Which says, for legal purposes, all what matters is what? Terms of the heading, section notes, and chapter notes. Terms of the heading, section notes, chapter notes. It's a law. It's a must. Those things are hugely important. So what's the terms of the heading? Well, that one is easy. recall my favorite plastics chapter, chapter 39. Remember that articles for conveyance of goods, 115. Recall this. Bags, for example. Those are the terms of the heading. This is a heading. This is a subheading. So heading in itself provides those terms. In order to move on, it's legally required for you, for that particular article of plastic, the sack, the bag, to be used, notice, use versus make, where in plastics chapter, so we're good, because 39 provides for articles of plastic.